Hi, everybody. Thanks for joining us this evening, and a big thanks to Rob Stevens for inviting us to do this presentation at our virtual assembly this year. I don't know about you, but I miss going to Paul Smith's. I'm really looking forward to getting back there next year. We are Jim and Betsy Wilson. I'm Jim.
I'm Betsy.
She's Betsy.
Hey.
And now just a little bit about the two of us. We are avid canoe enthusiasts. We paddle quite a bit, and we've been going to assemblies since the year 2000. I've missed one assembly since then. We're also avid amateur photographers. We've been doing this for quite a while also. And we've had quite a few photos published in the Wooden Canoe Journal. And I think 2 issues ago, Bets?
Yeah.
2 issues ago, we had a feature done on us with quite a few of our photos in it. We're also the editors of the Wooden Canoe Journal, Wooden Canoe Calendar. And if you send in pictures to be considered to go into the calendar and you haven't gotten in yet, you can blame her.
Thanks. Blame him.
No, blame her. Okay, I'm going to show you a few pictures now. A few of mine. Just to tell you, we don't just photograph canoes. We do other things too. We photograph all kinds of things. Here's a shot here from Philadelphia City Hall. This was taken from the top floor, looking down along the staircases there. This shot was at the Battle of the Brandywine, which happens every year near where we live in southeastern Pennsylvania. I was interested in the 2 rows of tents here. So I just kind of sat down on the grass and waited for somebody to walk through. And sure enough, this drummer after the battle walked through. And I thought it made for a really nice shot. Okay, this shot was done on Cape Cod a couple of years ago. We had gone up there with a number of our photography friends, and we had taken a bunch of shots of the sunset a little bit further down, and we were walking back, and all these clouds rolled in, and I got this shot, and I thought it felt like these clouds are just hovering or looming over the dark building, and made me feel like an Alfred Hitchcock movie. All right, this shot, Antelope Canyon, Arizona. A lot of people take pictures in this canyon. It's very well known, very popular. And a lot of them start looking alike after a while. But I was really lucky because this osprey flew all the way from Delaware just to be in this picture.
Yeah, right.
Either that or Photoshop. I'm not sure which, to be honest with you. Now we're in Grand Central Station in New York. I was interested in the light on the floor here and the shadows that they were throwing. So I started taking a lot of pictures of people coming down through the hall. And then I realized that the shot really isn't so much the people, the shot is the shadows. And I got lucky, and this young girl walked along with her father and made it for what I think is a really interesting shot.
And a few of mine. Getting down low and using a fisheye lens, that provided a unique perspective of this building. And this is in Hopewell Furnace Village in Pennsylvania. But in this one, I like the way that the leaf leads your eye up into the image. I'm often laying on the ground taking pictures. This is the center of a purple anemone flower. But we're fortunate to live near Longwood Gardens in Pennsylvania. So we have access to beautiful flowers all times of year. This was done with a macro lens, which is a close-up lens, because I really enjoy getting close to subjects and capture those details. As winter melts into spring, tens of thousands of snow geese flock to Middle Creek Wildlife Refuge. And the geese are stopping for rest, for food, for shelter, and it's on their migration. So it's a bit chilly this time of year, but it is a favorite stop for locals to stop and enjoy the spectacular sights and sounds. I mean, when 100,000 geese lift up in unison, it's really incredible. So during the pandemic, we did a lot of photography of things in and around our house. This is a simple still life. Was done by adding some dramatic light to these pairs. I did that with a small flashlight. And this was taken prior to the pandemic. This is at a place called the City Museum in St. Louis. It's a former shoe factory. And the workers would send the finished shoes down these chutes to the floors below. So this is a long exposure photo because it was rather dark inside, but it shows the amazing 10 stories of chutes and ladders. And Jim and I climbed all the way to the top and we slid down. It was fun.
Okay, well, before we really dig in here, we're going to go over a few basics. First thing, know your camera. You can't take consistently good photographs if you don't know your camera. So read your manual. I know you hate doing that, but read your manual. Get out and practice. Make mistakes. Learn from those mistakes. Experiment. Get creative. And shoot often. We'll be referring back to these things as we go along.
So we're going to go over a series of our top tips for photography, and I'm going to start with get up early. So you'll be seeing many images that were taken from prior wooden canoe assemblies. Those of you who have been there will recognize this area. So one of my favorite things to do at assembly is to get up before sunrise and get the canoe out on the water. Because there's a beautiful mist on the lake most mornings as the sun starts to warm up the overnight cool air. The combination of the morning sun and the mist creates this beautiful veil and a warm glow that adds a somewhat mysterious feel to an image. And of course, there is a gentle, beautiful solitude when you're out before everyone else gets up, or almost everyone else. Here the sun is warming up and the mist is starting to burn off. I love how the canoeist appears almost ghost-like as he emerges from the mist. An early morning light is low to the ground, and it's not only a warmer light, but the low direction tends to be more pleasing in photographs as opposed to harsh overhead midday light. And of course, you get up early, you may be treated to a beautiful sunrise.
And for those of you who don't like to get up early before sunrise, you can only shoot later in the day. Shoot those sunsets. We have photographic friends who will only shoot at sunrise and sunset. Forget the rest of the day, that's when they take their naps. So the hour before sunset is commonly called the golden hour. And if you look at this photograph here, you can see why it's called that. Here's the shot of Al Bratton paddling his decked canoe, and you can see the canoe itself almost looks like it's made out of gold. And that lighting is really accentuating the water coming off the paddle. So as the sun is setting, you can really feel the warmth almost and just the relaxation of gliding along in your wooden canoe. Also, at that time of day, you get to shoot sunsets. Everybody loves to shoot sunsets. The best days to shoot sunsets are when you have some clouds. If you just have a bare sky, it's pretty boring usually. You just get a colored sky and then it goes away and that's it. But if you have the clouds, they light up and they create some drama for your shot. Once you take a shot like this, turn around and look in the opposite direction. Because often if you have clouds in the opposite direction, the sun will light those clouds up and create a really impactful photograph. This is a shot that Betsy took up at Paul Smith's, and I just really like this shot a lot. I love the foreground with the pickerel weed in it and the light on that, the reflection of the clouds in the water, the God rays in the sky, the beautiful sky. It's a wonderful shot taken right at sunset. Once sunset's over, for the next hour or so, you have something called the blue hour. The color of the light actually starts turning a little bluer, and the camera accentuates that blue. Here's Barclay Ford, and he's practicing his poling. It's actually a pretty boring sky, but the color is nice, and we've minimized it by moving the horizon up in the frame, and the water just looks so blue because of that light. Now getting deep into the blue hour, It's getting pretty dark right here. This shot was taken a few years ago up at Assembly, Paul Smith's, and the group, the freestyle group that comes up and joins us, they were there this night and they put glow sticks on their canoes and paddled around. So that gave us some good photographic opportunities. That plus there's still a moon up there behind the clouds and you can see some light on the water down below. And we mentioned a little bit earlier about being creative and experimenting. Well, that's what we're trying to do here. This was done, we got some strings of LED lights. Now you can buy the cheap strings and we wrapped them around the paddle's shaft. And Betsy set up on the shoreline with a tripod and I paddled through the frame. We left the shutter open for 20, 30 seconds and I paddled right through it. So you're actually seeing the strokes of the paddle there. Although, because I'm moving through and it's such a long exposure, you don't see the canoe. Same thing here. You see the strokes, but you don't see the canoe.
So, and Jim said before to make mistakes. Well, this was actually a happy mistake. In low light, the shutter on the camera has to stay open long enough to allow enough light to reach the sensor. So it can create motion blur because the camera's open for a long time. So these look like beautiful curved canoes nestled beneath some mountains. But this is the actual scene when I held the camera a bit more steady. These are the houses along the lake. Again, we're coming back to Paul Smith's college. And this is what happens when I intentionally, or in this case, unintentionally, move the camera during a slow shutter speed. This was taken from a moving canoe, so it was probably just the rocking motion from the paddling. So it's rather abstract, but I like it.
Okay, use the rule of thirds. The rule of thirds is a compositional technique that's been around for quite a while. It says, put your subject on an imaginary grid line one third of the way into the image. There's a couple of examples here. There's this guide boat gliding across the lake and it's situated about one third of the way up from the bottom of the frame. You'll also notice that the shoreline, the far shoreline, that's a little better than a third of the way down. So the boat has placed on this grid line. It's like a tic-tac-toe board. Now, this is not something the photographers made up. This has been around since hundreds of years ago. Da Vinci used it, Rembrandt used it, yeah. Monet used it, all the great painters use the rule of thirds. This is our friend Susan Christie. She's out watching a couple of loons and you can see the rule of thirds being used here at the far shoreline. And Susan's about a third of the way in from the left-hand side of the frame. Right here, here's the shot. We've got a canoeist in the mist and he's dead center in the frame. Well, there's nothing wrong with this picture, really. It's, you know, it's a nice enough picture, but you can make it more interesting by reframing, taking another shot and putting him in the lower left-hand side of the frame. And we're also using another technique here. I don't know if there's a name for it, but what you do is you set up your frame and you set up your composition in something like this with the paddler having a place to go in the picture. So he's actually paddling into the wider, the wide open part of the frame. We'll do something similar here. Here's a shot, subject dead center in the frame, turned it into a square format, and we moved him to the left side of the frame and he's leaning into it. Okay, here we have two subjects, one in the lower left and one in the lower right, still using rule of thirds.
I love using reflections and shadows. So we talked already about shooting early in the day or near sunset for maximum light, but harsh midday light can also be wonderful, especially if you're looking for dramatic shadows like this. Sunlight pouring through trees cast wonderful leaf shadows on the lake and on the red canoe. Shadows from the window, creating some dramatic light on Jim's collection of paddles. So he did this by placing a bright light outside facing into the room. And of course, reflections, they just add a lot of interest and beauty to any canoeing image. And you can find them any time of day. I love the warm reflection here. This was taken during one of the paddle bys at assembly. And not only the canoe, but the reflection of dramatic clouds in the lake give this a lot of character and beauty. Reflections are also effective on a misty day. There's just enough light to cast a dreamy mirror image of the canoe. The rainbow of colors in the water reflected from the trees that made this a memorable image of this was just a beautiful autumn paddle. And a different kind of reflection. In this one, the colorful leaves are reflected in the varnish on the stripper. And this has quite a painterly look, rather abstract, as it's more about the reflection than the boat.
How'd you get that painterly look?
There are filters you can use after you take the photo, and it's not that hard. Actually, a lot of cell phones have these filters.
Okay, this is one of my pet peeves. It's probably the pet peeve, actually. Keep your horizon straight. I hate crooked horizons. You can paddle upstream on a lake, on a river, or on a creek, but I don't know anyone that can paddle uphill on a lake. So either get it right in the camera the first time or fix it in whatever software you use when you're editing your photos. A lot of the newer cameras actually have levels built right into the viewfinder. So makes things really simple for you, but please, please, please get it straight.
It's you.
Oh, I'm doing this too. Shoot details. When you're out paddling, you're going to want to take pictures of canoes. If you're assembly, you want to take pictures of canoes. Well, don't stop at taking that big picture of the canoe with the trees in the background and everything is properly composed with rule of thirds and all that kind of thing. Take the detail shots, get in closer and get more interesting shots that way. We actually are using another compositional technique here, and that's using diagonals. Diagonals have a tendency to add some dynamic forces to the image. In this case, we've got one paddle going diagonally across, and we've got the gunwale going diagonally across in the other one. So you've got this nice shot sitting in these lily pads here. The details are important. These are things that you remember from your trip, and it's not always boat related. Things like this spider web and this backlit, which makes it really interesting. Or maybe these moths on this daisy. Another canoe paddle, this time hovering over the bottom of the boat. Once again, using diagonals, with the paddle coming from the upper right going down to the lower left, and the ribs upper left to the lower right. This is much more interesting than if you were to have either a vertical or a horizontal paddle. And here we are again trying to be a little creative and experimenting. You see the ribs, you see the planking, and the whole thing is covered up with the shadow from the caning on the seat above it. And take pictures of the personalization that people do with their canoes. In this case, balloon painted on the bow of the sailing canoe. Or George Wilkinson's canoe that he built. Nice brass tag on it. This particular shot, detail shot, actually tells a story. It tells the story of a blustery day with this sailing canoe and the burgee flying in the wind. Notice we're using the rule of thirds here, both with the mast and the burgee flying. This shot is everything central, but it's all about form and it's all about shape, the paddles, the ribs, the rails, the whole thing. And here is a group of birch bark canoes that were sitting on the lawn at Paul Smith's many years ago at assembly. Just a lot of detail and a lot of texture without showing a single whole canoe except for that one model on top.
So often you can find natural elements and it actually creates a sort of frame for your shot. So in this case, the solo paddler, it's nicely framed by that curving tree branch and the canoe in the foreground. In this one, I saw the sailing canoe approaching, and I just waited until it was just in that perfect spot to be framed by those pine trees. The summer flowers create a colorful frame. This is right outside the dining hall at Paul Smith's. I think framing a subject adds a lot to the interest of a photo, and it helps to give a sense of the environment. I think it's just much more interesting than a shot of just a canoe in the water. Unusual perspective. Jim said before, experiment, get up high, get down low. Because getting down low, I like doing this a lot. It adds a different, unique perspective. When you think most photographs are taken from standing height, and they all look the same. But if you get up higher or get down low, you just give it a different look and adds interest. For this one, I got below the canoe and I shot up into the sun for a different look. How about getting under the canoe for a shot? For those of us who carry canoes on our heads, you know, this is a familiar sight.
Oh, yeah.
And you know that pesky uninvited spider that sometimes goes for a ride in your canoe? Well, this is that spider's view. Similar perspective, but this time of a canoe that is in pretty desperate need of some repair. I love that grass coming up through it. Now here's a really unusual perspective. Hold the camera underwater. This was, of course, done with a waterproof camera. So we like to take a waterproof camera with us because in addition to interesting shots like this, where we have the camera completely submerged, you can hold the camera right down next to the water to get a shot like this. Again, a very unique perspective. So holding the camera right at water level, it can create some interesting reflections. And actually, I like this one. It's sort of the reflection of the paddlers in the side of the canoe that I'm in. I'm holding the camera over the side of the canoe and getting down way low. So our camera actually has this little floaty thing on it. It's like a life jacket for a camera so that if I do drop it, I won't lose it. And here's a very different perspective from way above. You'll see in the credit in the bottom right there, it says photo by Ed Heaton. These are the only three images in this that are not taken by either Jim or me. He had a drone. There's another one with the drone shot from above. And one more. So he took these shots and he also at the same time did a video. And you can see the video on the Wooden Canoe website. And it's actually pretty funny because you can see the paddlers looking up above them as they're trying to figure out what this thing is flying around. It sounds like a giant mosquito. Sometimes an odd angle can be effective. Here's Jim's diagonals he was talking about. But if you do this, make it bold. If it's just a little bit off kilter, it can look like a mistake. Or you can use a different lens. A wide angle lens can distort images, giving it a surreal look.
Okay, here's another rule. Don't put the horizon in the middle of your frame. Sometimes if you put it smack in the middle, you can really cut the image in half, and that just doesn't work often. So usually what we try and do is we decide whether the stuff in the front or in the lower portion of the frame are more interesting than what's in the top or the back portion. So your foreground, is it more interesting or is the background more interesting? In this case, we decided that the foreground was more interesting, so we moved the horizon up in the frame. This was the opposite. We decided that the background was more interesting with those autumn colors, so we moved the horizon down in the frame. Same trip. This time, we moved the horizon up because we liked that leaf all the way down in the bottom of the frame and the reflections. I guess you can figure out what the feature is here. It's the lily pads, obviously. So horizon went up. And watch your background. Sometimes you get photobombed. We all get photobombed. We all photobomb people. That's half the fun of being a photographer, is photobombing people. But if you wait a minute, you can get that shot you were looking for. Now, Try and make a habit of looking through your frame before you actually take the picture, because sometimes things pop up out of people's heads that you didn't even realize were there because you're focused so much on the subject that you forget to look around. So in this case, this is our friend Ed Heaton again, the drone man, and he cooperated by doing this for us just for things like this. Yeah,
we did this one on purpose, but
we
it
did
always,
do it on purpose.
It yes. always amazes me how often there's something weird growing out of someone's head, a tree coming out of their
things
head.
Things just show something. Up that you didn't know were
yeah,
there.
Yeah, you didn't see them when you were taking the shot.
So try and make a habit, especially around the edges. Work your way around the edge of the frame before you push that shutter button, because things will show up that you had no clue were there when you took the picture. It'll be a no trespassing sign over in the corner that you didn't know, or somebody will be over there changing his shoes. But we have a name for things like that. We call them
edge boogers.
Edge boogers, yes. So look around the edge of your frame before you push.
And keep it simple. So photography is different than painting. A painter starts with a blank canvas and adds elements. A photographer starts with everything that is there, but often can increase the impact of a photo by eliminating distracting elements. So this image is nice, I like it, but the colorful dry bags are distracting, and I think they take away from the beauty of these wooden canoes. So my canoe buddies now know that when we get to a stopping place, they just go ahead and take out their plastic accessories because they know I'm going to want to take pictures. Just beautiful wooden canoes basking in the sunshine.
Betsy?
Yeah.
What's that in the upper left-hand corner there?
Oh, gosh.
Right there.
Edge booger.
Edge booger.
Thanks.
Get rid of it.
So this one, it just uses a simple color palette. The warm reddish-orange color of the boat clearly stands out in contrast to the cool blues and greens of the landscape. And this one captures a delightful scene, but we can actually get even a little bit more personal. By zooming in on just some of the details, it creates a more intimate feeling. And okay, I can tell you were here for this one. The beer bottle gives it away. So don't always try to include the entire subject in your frame. Sometimes just a portion is more effective. And repetition can be used to simplify an image. The repeating patterns of these gorgeous canoes are nicely lined up. And here, a simple composition, but there is a quiet, peaceful beauty, especially the pastel light on the water. And it kind of makes you wonder what happened here. This shows a study of rib bending, and it shares the story behind our love of canoe building. Varnished thwarts hanging from the trees to dry. This shows our ingenuity when we're challenged, trying to find a workshop big enough for our hobby. I just want to point out one other compositional thing that we did here. When Jim took this, he moved around just slightly so that those thwarts were separated from one another and they weren't on top of one another. They weren't merging. Again, he really looked carefully before he clicked that shutter. Here, the simplicity of paddles leaning on a tree. Is the journey about to start, or has it just ended? Back to you.
Photograph people. Some of your best memories when you go out on a canoe trip aren't just the canoes, and it isn't just the river or the lake. It's the people that you're with, too. So you want to preserve those memories by taking pictures of people. And assembly is a great place to do that. You meet up with old friends that you haven't seen in a year. You make new friends. So make sure you shoot a lot of people. And here we are trying to be a little different again. I took this shot from the second floor of the LMS dormitory at Paul Smith's. Here's a group of paddlers preparing their paddle for the following day. And kids, it's a great place to photograph kids. Let's face it, I'm an old guy, and if I go to my neighborhood playground and start taking pictures of kids I don't know, I'm going to get in trouble real fast because I'm a creepy old man. But at assembly, we photograph everybody, including the kids. So you've got this one shot of this young guy who just finished making his sailboat. He's going to be getting it out on the lake to sail it. And then there was this group that did this game that involved putting a shower cap on their heads, and then you put shaving cream all over that, and then their partner would throw cheese balls to try and get them to stick on their heads. I say, Marigold and Lily Welsh do a great time, do a great job with the kids
they
program.
Do. They really do.
There's a couple of guys launching those canoes, just standing out there in the water having a good time. And I ran into these two young ladies outside the dining hall there, and I was interested in their hairstyles. They actually took 2-liter bottles, empty 2-liter soda bottles, stood them on their heads, and then tied their hair up around it. And they obviously wanted to have their picture taken, so I obliged them. Betsy and I have a lot of pictures from paddling. Most of the pictures are pictures of me. There are not a lot of pictures of Betsy paddling because I'm always paddling and she's taking pictures.
I did my share.
Yeah, right. All right, here's a couple just relaxing in a canoe. Notice we're using the rule of thirds here. And here's our friend Bruce, who somehow manages to take that relaxation to a new level. He takes a pair of paddles, spreads it out between a couple of thwarts, and manages to lay down and fall asleep. He really conks out, and we have to wake him up when he does this. And take the fun shots. Take the fun shots. These are memories you're working on here. Here's some muddy feet. Everybody gets muddy feet sometimes. Here's Barkley Ford, all dressed up and ready to go. And here's my Uncle Dudley. Uncle Dudley comes out and paddles with us like the week before Halloween every year. We go over to our local state park and we put him in a canoe, give him a paddle and tow him around the lake. And there's actually people that expect to see him there every year and they know him by name.
Yeah, kids love it.
The kids really get a kick out of it. And hot days. Those hot days, you got to cool off so we have some fun.
And take a selfie. So Jim took this one of himself while I was doing all the work paddling.
You're probably just drifting.
But hey, then it was my turn for relaxing. And that's my selfie in the bottom right. And sort of a selfie. I got a kick out of the shadow on the highway. Here I'm taking a selfie while Jim is stuck behind a tree. We're in the same canoe and he's behind the tree. This is in the Pine Barrens. It's very windy. So Jim is standing on a table in our sunroom at home with a fisheye lens. Fun selfie. And we sometimes use a timer or a remote control to activate the shutter to get a shot like this. So you can almost see in my hand up there, I'm actually triggering a remote shutter release.
Okay, well, now's your chance to break the rules, which is something I always enjoy doing. Now that you know some of them, go ahead and destroy them. Okay, remember we told you don't put anything in the center of the frame? Well, that means this is a bad picture, right? No, it's not. Reflections work really well when you stick them in the middle of a frame. Another shot, same kind of thing again. Boat sitting in the middle of the frame vertically and with the reflection, it works great. All right, here's a case where we couldn't decide whether we like the foreground, the lake, better than the sky. So we featured both of them, just put the horizon right in the middle. You have both parts that are beautiful. So they're your images. If you want to put the horizon in the middle, fine. If you want to put the boat in the middle, fine. It's yours, you do what you want with it. And there's only one person you have to satisfy and that's yourself.
And take your camera with you. So I sometimes drive Jim crazy.
Sometimes?
I'll say, Jim, there's an eagle in that tree. Paddle backwards, paddle upstream. And thank you, you did it.
You're welcome.
And I got this shot actually from a canoe. We had gone under this eagle's nest and I saw it and he paddled back so I could get it. So we can sometimes witness nature from a canoe much more intimately than we can from land. And you never know when a loon might pop up right next to you. If I didn't have my camera with me, I would have missed capturing little surprises like this. And I actually never expected to see log rolling in action, but it was a fun event to watch, and I'm glad I had my camera. maybe even to catch candids like this. I think he was teaching a paddling class.
Yeah.
Who's that?
Caleb Davis.
Caleb Davis. Yeah. And I don't think this guy was teaching. This may have been an unplanned swim. I'm not sure, but it's a fun shot. And Uncle Dudley isn't teaching anything. He's just out to catch some rays and work on his tan. But you never know when you might see the perfect lineup of beautiful canoes resting on a bank of wildflowers, or paddle under the shadow of a dragonfly, or hike in the woods and come close to a little wildlife. Sometimes our worst weather experiences are our most memorable. And I was really happy that Jim had his camera nearby when this sunset happened. We were camping with some canoe buddies and this sunset came up quickly and it went away quickly. So glad you were ready. So we actually have special dry bags for our cameras that go around our waist. So we can keep our cameras dry and we have them accessible. We have them with us at all times, even when we're in the canoe. So here the colors of the trees just perfectly complemented the colors of our canoes. So again, I was just glad I had my camera. And I was ready when these ducks decided to photobomb my picture of Susan Christie. A rainbow of canoes just waiting to get on the water. And a rainbow of handprints and our wonderful assembly leader, Rob Stevens.
Okay, well, we're gonna start wrapping up here. We'll have a short slideshow. It's a little like 3.5 minutes or so. Three of our favorite places to paddle, one being Trap Pond in southern Delaware, one being the Pine Barrens in southern New Jersey, and the other one being the ever popular Paul Smith's. So let's get this thing up and running and... Thank you. Okay, we're back. We've got one last shot that we want to show you. A number of years ago at Assembly, a shot was done involving a very large canoe and a bunch of ladies who were willing to show off. So we decided it's time to recreate that picture. So 2 years ago at Assembly, we started looking for a war canoe to use. We hunted all over the place, finally found a couple of them in the rafters in one of the outbuildings, but we decided it was a little too dangerous to try and get them down. We'd probably hurt ourselves. So we started looking around some more, and we did find another boat that we could use underneath the dining hall. It's not a war canoe, but it's a big long canoe. We figured that'd be good enough. Well, we had a real hard time finding that boat, but we had no problem whatsoever finding a bunch of ladies who were willing to show off. So we got the ladies, and we got the boat, and we got the shot.
And there it is.
And it was a lot of fun doing it, I'll tell you.
It was fun.
Yeah.
We had some help.
Yeah, we did have some help. We had a lot of helpers on that one. But we're pretty well wrapped up here right now, but we will be back live in just a few moments. So bear with us, and we'll be back on live in person with you, and you can ask us any questions you want, any comments you have to say.
So we both want to thank you. We've enjoyed it. There are our websites down in the bottom if you want to check out any more of our shots. Thank you, and happy paddling.
Happy paddling.